Hi folks, this is David Kwan here, and I hope this is my last video, or last vlog, on Final Fantasy XIII 2, a Japanese role-playing game I thoroughly enjoyed playing. And out of the whole trilogy, I haven't finished Lightning Returns Final Fantasy XIII just yet, but yeah, I think this sequel, I think when I first heard about it, I was like, what? Final Fantasy XIII was so... You know, just there were so many negative comments about that game. I was so surprised that there was a sequel to it. And I was like, that's so weird. Why would they do that? But I'm kind of actually glad that they did so, because I like it a lot. I like Final Fantasy XIII 2 a lot. And yeah, it's kind of really, you know, there are many problematic things about this game, so I do understand. I can actually relate to a lot of people who are like, they should never have made this game. They ruined this game. They ruined the franchise. Not the franchise, but the trilogy. Final Fantasy XIII trilogy with this game. Or they should not even have had a trilogy. It should have ended with Final Fantasy XIII, the game. There are fans of Final Fantasy XIII out there who don't like the sequels. They do exist, apparently. It's not just people who don't like Final Fantasy XIII. And whatnot. I like a lot of the story elements of Final Fantasy XIII. And I also liked some of the many combat moments in 13. XIII has some challenging and quite interesting boss battles. 13-2 not so much. 13-2's boss battles and combat is like so easy. There's not too much strategy involved, but it's a fair system. I think 13-2 is a fair system. 13-1 had a lot of moments that were not fair, which is why, especially with if Lightning or the main character in your party dies, it's game over. You know, that's so unfair when some of the enemies can randomly do one-hit kills of your character. You just gotta hope that it's not your main character of the party, because that's game over. 13 had that, but 13-2 doesn't have that, so it's great. So 13-2 is a lot more open-ended with the whole time-traveling aspect thing going on that makes the story really convoluted and messy, but it does continue the theme. There is a thematic thing that kind of goes along with Final Fantasy XIII trilogy as a whole. It's a very morbid theme. You know, Final Fantasy XIII is a very colorful game, but I think story-wise, its theme gets super morbid and super dark and super pessimistic. And then Final Fantasy XIII 2, I think, magnifies that to a whole degree. So now we're going into whole spoiler territory. So if you care about that, stop watching this video. But yeah, spoiler stuff. There are 7 alternate endings that you can, I guess, unlock in this game. About half of them, I would say, is just going back to fight the boss battles with the alternate ending ability turned on, the paradigm thing turned on, and then you fight it without doing kind of story sequences, and you just fight head on, like that big colossal weapon thing. Instead of activating the paradox machine, just fight it head on. It's a much tougher fight, but if you have leveled up your character by that point, that fight is a breeze. And then there's a giant Flan. I like that storyline that you beat. So some of them are just kind of engaging in boss fights with the paradox thing turned on. You also have to fight Caius twice. Once as Sarah and once as Noel. Fight as Sarah is the most difficult boss fight, I would say, in this game, because Sarah is a lot weaker, Caius is a lot more stronger, and you have to fight him by yourself without the two characters. And the Final Fantasy XIII 2 combat system is really designed with the three people party system in mind. So that is a super, super difficult fight. But the theme, I think, continues, because none of the alternate endings except for one is happy. They all end like the world gets destroyed. Like the alternate ending about the giant weapon. The ending is now the humanity has created the these humongous giant weapons. By the time we turn to 500 AF, humanity has pretty much wiped itself out with war, and these giant machines are still warring against each other, and it's going to be an endless war between the two factions of who created this giant machine monsters, and they're just going to be constantly in eternal warfare over each other, and that's the state of the world and how it ends. And Sarah and Noel are going to be really just part of this war for whatever. That's one ending. The giant flan ending is just a weird... That's a weird ending. Like, I don't understand how this is an alternate ending where some of the characters have decided to change themselves, disguise themselves into flan, and feed poison to the giant flan. And hopefully that works. Okay. So that's one ending. Oh my god. So another ending is Sarah accepts the dream of being in this paradise world where she meets with lightning, but it's not reality. She accepts that dream, and so that's one ending. But of course, that's a dream. So we know that in the real world, you know, by the time 500 AF comes, the world will be destroyed, and Noel will be the last surviving human being on the planet by 700 AF. None of the endings are really happy. You know, there is this constant theme. No matter what Sarah and Noel do, the ultimate result is a fucked up world. Like, that's a theme, and it's really morbid. Like, you know, you can try to change time all you want, but it's really not going to change the ending, is it? What I thought was really intriguing was this notion that if you change the future, then you also change the past. And if you change of course people will think if you change the past, you'll change the future. But people don't really think about it in terms of, if I go into 200 years in the future and I change the events of the future, they don't really think about it affecting the past, which it does. And then that's why Noel starts forgetting some of the stuff that actually happened in his life, because his memories are changing too. Because that never happened, because the future was changed. So I like that idea a lot, except that it's, Yul repeats that line so many times, it's kind of annoying. Like, okay, we get it. We get that the future changes, what the past changes if you change the future. We get it, okay? You don't need to repeat that line four more times, which Yul does. But also this notion that there are so many versions of Yul, right? And Caius has to be the guardian of all of them. So trillions of Yules. And Caius has stood by and watched every single Yule die. And as a teenager, as a very young age, Yule dies. And just, I can't imagine how devastating that... So that's, I think that makes up Caius' motive so well. Caius is very similar to Seymour in Final Fantasy X, but I think Caius' characterization in Final Fantasy XIII is just fantastic, and it's so engrossing. I think he's definitely the most captivating character in this game. The character with the best voice acting, the most interesting characters, and the badass villain. So what the super secret ending that you unlock by doing, you know, 100% complete of the game is where Caius gives his monologue, and he just says, you know, like, it's pretty amazing. Caius is still alive, of course. He's not dead. He's the one who set this plan in motion to unleash chaos upon the world to kill Etros, the goddess. That's been his intention all along. And he just gives this monologue that's starting with, like, the goddess is dead. Like, it's just such a powerful moment when it's like, all along, this was his plan. And that's why Final Fantasy XIII-2 ends the way it does, with Sarah dying in Noel's arms and chaos, just this black cloud just sweeping across the entire world and enveloping everyone in it. And it's just like, what? What just happened? And it's like, to be continued. It ends on a cliffhanger, but I feel like it ends on such a powerful note, but like, well, what's going to happen next? And then it picks up with Lightning Returns, which I think is starts at a very weird place. They could have gone so many different ways with how it ended in Final Fantasy 13-2, and decided to start off with 500 years later, Lightning wakes up from crystal sleep. I think that's weird. But I do like the whole, that kind of theme. The only ending where it's just not a pessimistic world fucked up is the weird ending where you decide not to accept the Paradox Stone given by, God, I forget the character's name, but with the glasses and blonde hair. She was working with Caius all along, you know, giving you that flawed Paradox Stone, which is kind of what sets off. Snow comes in from out of nowhere. He's able to time travel. This is like a plot hole that's never addressed. How is Snow able to time travel? Makes no sense. He jumps 100 years into the future, coming to Academia 400 AF. And he's like, oh no, stop right there. Don't use that stone. This is, anyway, the backstory of how that girl was actually working with Caius, because she wouldn't exist with that time paradox. Like, that's so great. I like that subplot detail. And then, but the ending, that ending is a ridiculous ending. Like, what? What? Wait, come again? Seriously? Snow's like, let's go on an adventure. We gotta find 13 more of these, like, things. And they're out there in all kinds of time. And they go on this super hovercraft, like, let's go, Sarah. Let's go save the world. And they fly and they disappear to a different time and place. What the heck? Snow had a time-traveling machine all this time? What? And now they're going to collect stuff? How is that going to help? Like, what? And fight Caius? What about Caius? What about all this other stuff? That ending was so unrelated. I feel like that ending was written by someone else who was totally not related to, who was not involved at all or not aware of the actual overarching story of Final Fantasy 13-2. Just like happens out of nowhere. Although, the detail that the girl, I forgot the name of the blonde woman character, you know, that she would do this about ulterior motive, you know, because she wouldn't exist without the time paradox, so she doesn't want the time paradox to be solved to save the world because she wants to keep living. That's just fascinating. I thought that was super powerful to discover. And so it's a little tiny details like that you could find in the alternate endings that I really, really enjoyed. Overall, it's a convoluted mess. Time travel, you know, when you usually involve time travel in a plot or in a story, goes all over the place. Final Fantasy 13 is definitely not the exception to that, and it does have really messy storyline overall. And it's a shame because this is a game that like really focuses on the plot a lot more than the characters themselves. Whereas Final Fantasy 13, the prequel, the original, focus more on the characters, the dynamics between the six characters and whatnot. But 13-2 doesn't really do that too much, other than to just kind of push the plot forward. And the plot is so messy, that can be problematic. But it was an enjoyable kind of thing to kind of try to piece together all these weird, convoluted time travel nonsense that I quite enjoyed. Yeah, I guess overall, you know, I would say Final Fantasy 13-2 is a great game. I think it's so remarkably different. It uses the same universe, same engine, so even some lame locations, very similar soundtrack, although remixed. Some of the soundtracks are kind of crazy in this game, actually. It's like, what? This isn't a Final Fantasy game? But as the prequel, so people who don't like Final Fantasy 13 might actually like Final Fantasy 13-2. People who liked Final Fantasy 13 might hate Final Fantasy 13-2. I've read a lot of comments that are examples of just that. Like, oh my god, Final Fantasy 13 was so great. Why did they ruin it with the sequel? You know? I actually really like Final Fantasy 13-2. Final Fantasy 13, there are aspects I like about it. And even more so than Final Fantasy 13-2. But it's a game that I will not ever play again because there's so many problems with that game. It's just not great for replaying. Whereas, I can imagine myself, years into the future, I might play Final Fantasy 13-2 again. Just because. Because, you know, it's a game that I ended up really cherishing for whatever reason. And it's a game that I really want to just talk a lot about because I enjoyed it so much. And that's kind of why I ended up making so many videos on this one game. Anyway, hope you guys enjoyed watching this. And if you guys have played Final Fantasy XIII 2, let me know what you guys think. If not, I guess, you know, that's, you're in the majority. Majority of people in the world have not played Final Fantasy XIII 2. So, congrats, you're in the majority. Anyway, if you guys enjoyed, cheers.